Good morning. Welcome to church. We're so thankful you're joining in with us this morning. We are going to get started. We're just going to start offering up just praise and thanksgiving this morning. We hope you're doing well, and we are just excited to have you here today. Father, you are so welcome in this place, God. We go ahead and just surrender to your presence, God. And Father, we just ask you to just sweep through each and every place today, God. I pray each and every one will have just a special touch and anointing today, that they would feel near to you today. Father, we just love you and honor you in Jesus' name. Amen.
to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior.
Sing with me how great is our God, and all will see how great, how great.
Praise this morning. Father, you are so welcome in this place, God. Father, we just surrender to you this morning, God, as the word is getting ready to come, God. I just pray, Lord, that you would just minister to each and every one. Father, it is a privilege to be here today, God, and we just serve and worship you this morning because you are the name above all names. There is no one else that compares to you, God. We love and honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen, everyone. Let me just get some room here. Thank you, David. How are y'all?
Good.
Y'all good?
Good.
Amen. Today is Pentecost Sunday. Did y'all know that? Yeah? Yeah, we're aware. We're fully aware of that. What you may not be fully aware of, though, is that Pentecost means 50, okay? So that means 50 what? Okay, so it's 50 days from first fruits. Okay, so back then and even today, our church is very renounced in sowing in first fruits. So you're on Facebook, you're watching us, let the redeemed say so. I want to know, besides me, I give God the glory for a harvest coming in right now,
But I want to know if you guys are receiving a harvest, because it's the season time for that. Amen. If you are, just key in and testify on Facebook and let us all know, because I think we need to give God glory. Amen. Yes. It's not bragging, it's testifying. Our church sows in first fruits. And because of that, there is a harvest, and it comes at this time of the year. And that's what Pentecost is all about. Amen. So, guys, just let us know what's going on. And, you know, let's try to keep as much contact as we can while we're doing this social distancing. I hope that this changes soon and we all get back together. I feel it in my spirit. I feel like something's going to shift with that. And I'm looking forward to that day. Amen. But for now, for right now, I want to talk about Pentecost, okay? Because it is Pentecost Sunday. Now, I saw something that I've never seen before. Never seen before. As much as I've read Acts chapter 2, and as much as I have studied the Holy Ghost in seminary, and as much as I have read this chapter over and over, there's two little words in there that it's never dawned on me for some reason, and I never saw it before, and I'm going to share it with you today. Those two words are the name of this message, and it's called "as of." So y'all look at each other and say "as of." Amen. So I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to settle in up here, and I'm just going to kind of talk to you, if I can, about the "as of." Okay, sorry, I lost my flip-flop. Okay, so home church, isn't that good? Amen. All right. Loving it. Okay, so, all right, let's talk about "as of" in just a minute. Pat will be putting the scripture up here in just a few, but let's just kind of build a little bit of foundation on what happened at Pentecost. Okay, I already said it was 50 days after first fruits, okay? It's the day when the Holy Spirit descended into the upper room, the Bible teaches us, and suddenly happened, all right? That's what the Bible says. Something suddenly happened. But what you may not realize is while the disciples were in the upper room, you have to remember why they were there, okay? Why were they there? All right? They were there because they were brought together. They were very frightened. The disciples were frightened, and they had come together because they were in fear of what the public would do to them. Now, remember what they had just done to Jesus. So here they are, frightened for their life, and they're in this upper room. Now, let me tell you, I was there. When it says room, in my mind, I thought it was a small space. It wasn't all that small. It was a lot bigger than my memory or my understanding of it or the way I perceived the scripture. Amen. But here they were, after Pentecost, these frightened men became suddenly and miraculously equipped and empowered to carry on the ministry and the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now look what just had happened, okay? All right? So this birthed something in them, okay, in the disciples, in what was a season and time of fear, come on, had been shifted now, and something miraculous and something, and we know that something is Jesus, amen, took place in them, the Holy Spirit, okay, took place in them and empowered them to start what Jesus was about to finish on earth. Okay, so there's a shifting that took place at Pentecost, and that shifting went from Jesus traveling, healing, saving, to that ministry was put on the backs now of his disciples. How many of you know that we are his disciples? Amen. Okay, so that's what happened on that day. So guys, don't, you know, something very miraculous happened, okay? So some people believe that Pentecost has meaning only for those who call themselves Pentecostals, okay? Now, guys, it has nothing to do with Pentecostals, all right? Just no more than it has anything to do with any other religion. It's so much bigger than that. The truth is, the history of the Christian church stretches back more than 2,000 years, amen? And while the Pentecostal movement, guys, wasn't even birthed into Azusa Street, in the revival in Los Angeles, California, that went on from 1906 to 1915, led by Seymour. Y'all remember, okay? That's a 9-year revival. Come on. All right. So just think about what God is doing right here, right today on this very, very important day. You know, we celebrate Christmas, we celebrate Easter, but guys, we don't celebrate too much when it comes to Pentecostal. Okay. Pentecost. We don't. Okay. But we do. And we need to realize that just as the disciples then were feared, you know, there's so many of Americans and people across the world who are fearing for their lives today due to COVID. All right. Or due to other situations that COVID has created. Okay. So fear has laid over the earth, the spirit of fear. Right here on the day of Pentecost, okay? So I see a lot of similarities because as they feared for their life in the upper room, so many today are fearing, you know, whether it's the next paycheck or whether it's, you know, the sickness itself, amen, okay? But I just want you to understand that Pentecost Sunday has nothing to do with Pentecostals or people who speak in tongues or, you know, it wasn't birthed because of that. Okay. They did speak in unknown tongues. However, that's not why it's here. Amen. Pentecost is no more Pentecost with Pentecostals than it is baptism with Baptists. I mean, that's just crazy, that assumption, because Pentecost Sunday happened, 19 years older than what Azusa Street did, okay? So I want you guys to understand. So let me talk about what Pentecost means to Jews. For Jews, Pentecost was a time when they celebrated the first harvest, the first fruits off of the harvest off the first fruits, okay? And it was their agricultural year. Amen. How many of you believe that it's their agricultural time? I'm seeing a harvest. I know many are seeing a harvest. God is still faithful. Amen. He's still on the throne and he's still ruling and reigning in our lives. Amen. So it was a time for the Jews when they gave thanks to God for what the land was producing. I want to tell you, they were excited. They were joyful. I mean, if you get a big check in the mail, you know, you're high-stepping. Amen. Or if you get a raise at work or whatever happens, you know, you get increase of some sort, then you're happy. Well, it wasn't no different for the Jews that day. They were stepping high, man. Their harvest was in. They made bank and they knew it, okay? Things were good. Life is good for the Jews at this time. Their field and labor was yielding. Amen. Come on. And so they were excited, okay? For Christians, Pentecost marks the birthday of the Christian church, the day when Peter actually preached, and in response to that sermon, there was a harvest of 3,000 souls, according to Acts. Now, later on, he preaches and adds to the church as well, and over 5,000 comes in total. So here we see that Peter gets about the Father's business, okay? But you remember, suddenly, something came down, okay, as of, and I'll get the scripture in a minute, a mighty rushing wind.
Amen.
Come on. All right, so it changed them, the disciples, so much and lit them on fire. Come on, how many of you know that we need a little fire? It lit them on fire enough to go out, amen, and preach the word to all that's lost. Come on, this is not an individual gospel. It is a personal gospel in the fact that you work out your own salvation in fear and trembling. I get all that. But the Bible and the message is meant to go out and to be preached. Come on, somebody. So what we need to do is we need to get some fire. We need to have a suddenly, as I preached before, and allow the Holy Ghost to move on the inside of us enough to where we will go out and preach and teach to a lost and dying world. Come on, somebody.
Come on.
So this is what happened to Peter. Now you have to remember, think about Peter. Peter, not Paul, not Matthew, not John, not James. We're talking about Peter. Peter, this is the same Peter who 53 days earlier had said, I never knew Jesus. Come on. This is the same Peter who had nothing to say about Jesus when somebody asked him directly if he was one of the followers of Christ. He said, no, he denied him three times. This is the same Peter that had a suddenly who was baptized with the Holy Ghost, who went out, amen, preached a sermon, and 3,000 came to Christ. The same Peter who was fearless enough to stand before the same crowd, amen, that he denied Christ with. Think that through. So that's what God can do to a man. He can change him from the very core, amen? From the very heart of man, he can take out a stony heart and he can make him alive in Christ, amen? Make him fearless, amen? Wow. We need Christians who are fearless, amen? We need Christians who will stand up and who will do the right thing in the wrong times, amen? I know it's bad. It's been a rough week. A lot of stuff is going on this week that I totally think it's just wrong to the nth, okay? And we'll talk about that. But I'm here to tell you right now that when we meet God, the Holy Spirit, we become powered from on high. That Holy Spirit comes on the inside of us. And guess what, guys? We are made witnesses according to the scripture, okay? We need to be fired up. We need to be forgiven. We need to repent and we need to be changed and then allow the work of God to change in our lives so we can go forward, preach to the individual, preach to the masses, preach to ever who God puts in your path. Amen. You might say, well, you don't understand, June, I'm not called to preach. Yes, you are. You are a disciple of Christ. You are called to preach every day. You preach every day, even if you don't open your mouth. People are looking at your life, amen, and they are lining it up to what they read in the Bible and what they know about God, even though they're not born again. They will judge you and look at you to see if you are who you say you are. So you're preaching whether you open your mouth or not. So why don't we get endued from power on high, amen? And why don't we start living the gospel that we read? Come on, somebody. I know I'm preaching good. Amen, amen, and amen. Come on.
Amen.
So when we meet him, we are changed. Man, can I talk about that all day? What God just done in my life, what he's done in yours and in yours, amen? God has done so much in our life. He took out those fleshly desires and he created godly desires, amen? And only God can do that. Only God is able to change the heart of man to the point like Peter that you can be fearless enough to go out to the same crowd that you denied Christ in front of and say, he is the way. Jesus is the way. He's the only way. And tell them that, you know what? We aren't crazy. We weren't drunk in the upper room. We wasn't drunk. We received the Holy Spirit with the power of speaking in tongues, and it made us drunken in the Spirit of God, not from wine, not from strong drink. Amen. So he preached that to the same crowd that he denied Christ to. Come on, Peter had it going on because he had a change. Yes, he had the same change that we can have today if we will only allow the fire to come down where we're at and change our hearts. Come on, somebody. So let me get to Acts and let me read it to you. Open your Bibles to Acts 2, 1 through 4. You know, the dirty page. The page that we Pentecostals, our non-denominationals, have actually worn out. It might have a hole in it. Why? Because we've had to actually refer to it so much to defend our beliefs. Absolutely. That the speaking in tongues and a manifestation of the power of God is real and how we had to back it up by the Word of God. So you should be able to easily find it in the Word. So let me read it to you. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of. Come on, do you see it? As of. Okay. Not is a, but as. as of. Why does it say as of? You're getting it just like I did. Because they hadn't experienced it before. It was something new. They couldn't understand how to explain it because it had never been experienced. Right. Wait, these were men who followed Jesus Christ. Yeah. Come on, is it dawning on you yet? Okay, so what had happened is they had had an infilling of the Holy Spirit, a second baptism, if you will, of the Holy Spirit in their life. And they had received this power. But when it was there, they said as of. Okay, so let me go back. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting, and there appeared unto them cloven tongues, like as of, come on, there we got it again, fire, and it set upon each of them. Come on, yeah, they didn't know what set out on them, amen? Come on. We are on the backside of it. When we speak in tongues, we know it's God. We know it's the Spirit of the Holy Ghost rising up in them. Can you imagine you speak English and you're sitting with 12 men and then all of a sudden you start speaking in another language? Talk about mind blowing. I mean, come on. I don't know what I would have done. Probably just fainted. I don't know what they did. I know it's empowered them and it set them on fire. Come on, y'all. So, and they appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it set upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. So that's what it was. It come from God. They didn't make it up. It says as the Spirit willed, as the Spirit gave. Come on. And when we speak in tongues, it's because the Spirit gives utterance. Do you see it? So in Acts 2:1-4, we are understanding that what starts out as an as of becomes an is a, okay? Because to us, it is a move of God. It is a empowerment. We know what it is. But them, when they were describing it, they didn't have words. They were like, it's as of a big wind. Mm-hmm. Come on, somebody. God must be experienced.
That's good.
God must be experienced. It's time we take him off of the pages. It's time we stop reading, just reading about God and become experiencing God.
Come on,
are you hearing me?
Yes.
See,
yes.
It was called the Feast of Weeks, wasn't it? Yeah, we know that. It was called the Feast of Weeks. Good. All right, 50 days after the first fruits was sown. Their fields were full, come on, because they had given God first. For those of you who don't know what first fruits is, it's when the first fruits come in, they give God from that first. They take God's portion off first, amen, and it's sown into the work and ministry of God. Our church does that. We're very passionate about keeping the commands of God. And because of it, we are such a blessed church. Because we have the knowledge, we have experienced God, and we understand the principles that thereby lie in first fruit offerings. But I'm not here about first fruits, but I just wanted to remind you. So as they were celebrating this beginning of harvest that took place, and what we're observing now in our time as Pentecost, okay, 50 days after the first fruit harvest, this starts to happen, this Pentecost movement, this Holy Spirit, okay? So let me just say this, that Peter did not simply change his mind, okay? All right? He didn't just simply change his mind. Peter denied Christ. Okay, we know what was birthed in him, the fleshly desires, amen? We saw it through the scriptures, okay? Just 50-something days earlier. But now we have a new Peter. Because when God comes on the scene and when you start to experience God, guess what happens? You become changed. Amen? And that on the inside, it says, once you've made the crossing, there's no turning back. Come on. So once you experience God in this form and fashion, there's no going back. And there was no going back for Peter. I know Peter ended up in prison, but not yet. God had a work for Peter. Come on. So something happened to Peter and to the other 10 disciples that changed them and set them on fire. And that something is Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay? Because when those disciples left, they turned the world upside down.
Yes, they did.
Do you see the shift from Jesus Christ, him, and followers to now Jesus is getting ready to exit? The Holy Spirit stays. The Holy Spirit is here now. Jesus is on the right hand of the Father, and we've got something to do. Amen? Our work and our call is to go forth and do what Jesus did. This is a transfer. This was a shift, amen, from what Jesus did. I'm out of here, guys. Now it's you, amen? And that's what happened on the day of Pentecost in the upper room. Jesus was shifting the power to his disciples, and you and I, my friend, are his disciples.
Come on,
that's better than y'all letting on. If y'all ain't running around the living room, that something ain't right. Come on, because I'm feeling this thing. So it says here in Acts 17:6. Now this is real good. This tells you what they got out of it. It says, here are those who are turning the world upside down. Come on. How many of us need to start turning the world upside down?
Come on.
Amen? And I don't mean in chaos and rioting and hatred. Come on, that's not what I'm talking about. Come on, that's wrong. That is so wrong. I'm talking about turning the world upside down with love. Amen? With helping your brother. With living the word of God. Come on. This is easy. So what happened to them, and what needs to happen to everyone who calls themselves a disciple of Jesus Christ, or saved, or Christian, or whatever word you want to put with it. Come on. Is
Amen.
Something called an inbirthing of Jesus, of the Holy Spirit. And it's what Pentecost is all about. There has to be a shift from an as of to a is a. That's what has to happen.
Mm-hmm.
There's too many as of Christians. Uh-huh. We need Christians who is a. Who understand and have experienced God. Come on. You need an is a God. Okay? He's everything we need. Amen? So Pentecost marks this outpouring that I'm talking about today of the Holy Spirit, and it equips us to do the work of God. We are not of our own selves. Amen? It's that on the inside of us. Come on. That leads and guides us and establishes us. Amen? So, Dr. Martin Luther King, and I want to talk about this just a minute, because what happened last week is not okay. And it wasn't the first time, okay? But Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. often referred to this as the beloved community. I'm going to tell you what we witnessed in the streets of Atlanta was not love. That's hatred. And I'm going to tell you that hatred is not going to resolve any problem. Amen? What's happening to our community, guys? Why are we here in this time and season? It's been a tough week. You know that. You know, I mean, people of color are having a hard time going out in the streets for fear of their life. That's not right. God doesn't see color. Christians don't see color. Love doesn't see color. Amen?
Try.
We don't see color.
Come on.
I mean, there's people. There's humans. You know, and whether it's gay, whether it's lesbian, we don't see that either. We let God deal with that. Amen? We love. That's what we're supposed to do is love. Come on. So I see a people with no fire is what I see. I see people that's like Peter who needs a change, who needs that experience God. Amen? That's what they need. Okay? We start out well, but what's hindering us? What's hindering us? Christians, let me talk to you just a minute. Because God has laid this on my heart very heavily. And I want to ask you, what's hindering you from doing the right thing with God? I mean, how many Christians were out looting the streets? It just makes no sense. Okay? And I want to say that you need to submit. Every person has to submit to authority. And that authority is Jesus Christ. And if we are not able to submit, we can't surpass. And I'm not saying we're going to surpass Jesus Christ, but he did say, greater things can you do than I've done, okay, because I go to the Father. When you have the Holy Spirit, it'll empower you to do more. Come on. If you submit, if you refuse to submit, you can't pass go. You don't get 200, and honey, you're going to land in prison. Your own prison. Right here. And you're going to have to take the test over and over and over that God sends, because he's going to wake us up. I think that we're in a season where God's trying to wake up the Christians. Amen?
Yeah, I do too.
Let me just tell you what the mayor of Atlanta said. I really like what she said. She said this, and I'm going to read it to you because I liked it. She said, what I see happening in the streets of Atlanta is not Atlanta. This is not a protest. This is not the spirit of Martin Luther King Jr. This is chaos. A protest has purpose. When Dr. King was assassinated, we didn't do this to our city. So if you love this city, the city that has been a legacy of black mayors and black police chiefs and people who care about the city, where more than 50% of the business owners in the metro Atlanta are minority business owners, they're still recovering from COVID. Come on. If you care about this city, then go home and pray. Come on, that's what we need to do as Christians. We need to pray. Okay, 1 John 4:20. Let's look at that. 1 John 4:20. You know it well. If anyone says, I love God, but hates his brother, he is a liar. I didn't say that. God said that. For anyone who does not love his brother whom he has seen, cannot love God whom he has not seen. Guys, there's no room for hate here. There's no room for behavior like that. Come on. Can I just say also that the only way we can change America is to pray and to repent? You know, what I agree, what they did to that man George was wrong. I'm totally in agreement with that. And my heart goes out to him and his family and for all the people of color, okay? All the minorities that they're looked down on, and it's unfair. It's wrong. My heart goes out to that. So I'm not belittling it, okay? But it's like that song that April and Pat sings. If you want favor upon you and your family and your children and their children and their children and their children, guys, we better get something right. And what the world is doing right now is not right. Well, June, I can't help what they're doing. They're over there causing a mess and blah, 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 blah. Yeah, we can. I am calling you to pray. Christians, if you haven't bunkered down and started praying, then now is the time. Do you see the season that we're in? You know, we've gone to church for years and talked about times like this coming. Here we are, and people are so lackadaisical to it. They're living in denial. And it's happening right before their faces, and they're acting like nothing's going on. Wake up. We need to wake up, guys, and we need to start praying. Okay? So Pentecost is the day when Jesus officially transferred his disciples and gave them the responsibility to go out and spread the message of salvation. That's what today's all about. And that's why this message today is very fitting. We need to experience God. No longer spectators. The disciples went into that upper room that day. They were spectators. But they came out. They weren't spectators at all. They were given power to go, and they were true disciples of Christ. Remember God when he made Adam? He formed him, the Bible says, from the clay and the dirt of the earth. Adam was a man laying there in possession of God, but he wasn't alive until God breathed into him. Zoe life. Come on. Into the nostrils of Adam is when he became a living soul. What about the Valley of Dry Bones in Ezekiel?
Come on.
Look what happened. Ezekiel spoke to the bones.
Yes,
okay.
Lord.
They came together to form a body. They stood before Ezekiel, but they were not alive. They were not alive until the Spirit of God blowed over those bones.
Come on, God.
And then they started waking up. Come on. There's too many dead Christians, and I'm here today to raise the dead. Come on, spiritually speaking. We, as a body of Christ, need to raise the dead. How do we do that? Then we blow life on them. Now, I'm not saying that I'm blowing into the camera and making, don't even go there. Okay, so don't even post that stuff. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that our words that comes from the Bible have power. And you can take those biblical words and you can change people's lives.
Come on, God.
You can pray. If nothing else, pray. Amen? That is one of the most powerful things that we can do as Christians. It puts all out assault on the enemy. Okay? So don't get distracted. Don't allow hindrances to come to keep you from your time with God and to work on your relationship with Him and to spend time in prayer.
Awesome.
Come on.
Awesome.
I see a very dangerous trend going on right now, and I'm concerned. You know, the church. I'm not talking about the heathens out there, okay, or the lost. Not right now. I'm talking about the church all across America, okay? They are shifting from repentance and forgiveness to self-righteousness and defensiveness. They see no wrong in nothing they do. They're so defensive. They don't ever do anything wrong.
Come on.
A man that can't admit his faults needs to check up. And that means us girls too. And I've never seen a time when people don't trust people or believe. And no matter what advice we're given from sound doctors, nobody believes it. It's all political. That's a shame. We've got to submit. And until we're willing to submit, you can't outgrow what you won't submit to. Come on, think that through. Joel said, God will pour out His Spirit. And I'm in Joel 2:28. God will pour out His Spirit on all flesh. And your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Even upon the men servants and maid servants in those days will I pour out My Spirit. See, Pentecost is the day when God tears down all the walls of division in the world and in the church.
Come on. Praise God.
Why do you think the devil's trying to separate? Why do you think we're not in churches across America? Why do you think this rioting is going on right now? Because today is the day of Pentecost, a much celebrated day, and I hope that you have a better understanding of how important today really, really is. What God is doing in the heavenlies that we don't fully understand, nor will ever fully understand until we get there with Him. And He teaches us for all the end of days. But this I know. There's work to be done. It's still daylight. And there is a remnant of people who are Holy Ghost filled.
Yes. Yes.
It's called
Jesus.
The church. And yes. Church, it's time that we rise up and deliver this message of the gospel
yes.
to a lost
yes.
and dying world. We need prayer. We need love. That's the recipe. What can we do? What's the answer to all this? I'm just one. One prayer can change. One can put 10,000 into flight. Don't say you're just anything, but in Christ you're all things.
Yes.
Because you have the Holy Ghost on the inside of you.
Exactly.
You're under His authority. Amen? If you speak the name of Jesus, this is a good test for you. If you speak the name of Jesus and nothing happens, then it means you're not submitting to God.
Yes.
You're just using a name that's doing you no good because you're not in submission to the authority and will of God in your life. But when you do submit to God and come up under His authority and you lay hands on people and you pray for them in the name of Jesus, you see results. That's true.
Come on,
right? Come on. That's the test. All right? And I'm going to end, guys, with this. On this third celebrated day that Christians recognize. First one, Christian Easter. Not in that order. It's Pentecost Sunday, and we need to accept the anointed power of God in our lives. We need to pray, and we need to share love. I'm going to tell you that anger is not the answer for anger. It's not. Love is the answer for anger.
Yes.
A soft word in love turns back anger, according to the scriptures. But if we go out and we become angry against angry, then more anger is produced. And we see the results of that, and it's not good. There's too many torn down and too many hurt. But we need to always answer in love, and there's not a but to it. But you don't understand what they did to us. But you don't understand. You know, he beat me, or he did this, or there's no but. Always answer in love, and God will reward you. Amen? He will. You'll come out blessed. And you know what? Because of that, you may restore a brother. You're certainly not going to restore him in anger. Isn't that true? So, I just want to ask you guys to apply what we've heard today. And let me just read this to you. And I'm going to read some scripture, and I'm going to pray, and we'll close, okay? In 1 John 4:20, it says, if anyone says, I love God and hates his brother, the Bible says he's a liar. I read that one. In Proverbs 10:12, it says that hatred stirs up strife, but love covers all offenses. Isn't that beautiful? That's what a Christian really is, guys. In 1 John 3:15, it says, everyone who hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding into him. Come on, that's strong. That means that if you hate somebody, then you don't have the hope and promise of eternal life. God said it, not me. So if you're going to get mad, don't get mad at me. And then I'll read Romans 2:1-4, and we'll pray. Therefore, you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges, for in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself, because you, the judge, practice the very same things. We know that the judgment of God rightly falls on those who practice such things. Do you suppose, O man, you who judge those who practice such things and yet do them yourself, that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? But because of your hard and impotent heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath when God's righteous judgment will be revealed. Come on. Let's all pray. Father, we thank you, Lord. We ask, Holy Spirit, God, to turn this country towards you. Help us not to be so hard-hardened and stiff-necked. I'm talking about the Christians now, God, who they won't listen. A people who refuse to listen. One that can only wake up due to pain or circumstances in a world of hurt. Father, some are led and won by love, and some are led and won by fear. But God, I pray that there'll be a shifting coming. And Lord, that those that need to see love and see what's real, see Christians who are actively seeking you and who are really making a difference. Father, I pray that those people will see that and they'll cry out to you for a deeper relationship. That's my heart's desire, Lord, is to see the hate turn to love. And Father, there's nobody that can do it beside you, the Holy Spirit, Jesus, yes. and us, the disciples.
Yes.
It's our responsibility. And Father, I pray that we will show love wherever we go, and our lives will mimic the work of the Holy Spirit. We love you, God, and we thank you for these words. In Jesus' name, amen. We love you today, and we thank you so very much for listening to us today and tuning in. Have a great week, and have a great week. Amen, and happy Pentecost.